Adichanallur as one of the 5 archaeological sites that would be developed as iconic sites with on-site museums. And this is particularly significant to the Tamil civilization, as the findings date back to 690 to 905 BCE. Not Adichanallur, not Adichanallur.
Don't disturb,
Nishan. No, don't get. Don't yield.
Time is not there.
Don't disturb.
But I would also like to draw the attention of this house to a point made by the finance minister in her budget speech. She has gone out of her way to rename the Indus Valley civilization as we know it as the Saraswati Sindhu civilization.
Shame, shame.
Even scholars, scientists, archaeologists who've been working for decades on this subject have not been able to come out with any conclusive or concrete proof about the existence of the mythical Saraswati River.
Shame, shame.
And what the Indus script says. The finance minister has followed the footsteps of some people who actually would like to push the Vedic age to 10,000 years BCE and to say that the river Saraswati mentioned in the Rig Veda is the same river on which the Indus civilization flourished,
which is the
most farthest from the truth. And this is a blatant attempt to rewrite history, as the BJP has attempted to always do. And they always love to give us history lessons, as we have been seeing regularly. And the government... The government not only attempts to paint contemporary India saffron, but it wants to go back in history and paint the past saffron too. Indologists like Asko Parpola and Airavada Mahadevan have categorically said that the Indus civilization is a Dravidian civilization. Yes. And the Murugan worship has gone from South India to the valley. And moreover, the minister has made a statement that deciphering of hieroglyphics of the Harappa has happened. And I would like to tell her, there is no conclusion. People are still debating about it, and nobody has been able to really read what is there. And I humbly request the government and the BJP to leave things like this to the scholars, historians. And I again,
very good.
And again, request the politicians to stay out of this and stop using their versions of religion to rewrite what India is.
Very good. Very good. Very good point.
Pardon? India had very high hopes for this budget, but I fail to see how any of the proposed allocations will boost the incomes and enhance purchasing power. A newspaper headline read, "Not a full thali, only morsels for everyone." This is what the long budget left us with. You've been talking about the $5 trillion economy and... $5 trillion economy. And Mr. Sinha has become very ambitious. He's talking about the $10 trillion economy.
Next finance minister.
And I really can't... I could not see anywhere in the budget where allocations, we have to start making allocations for equity funding for this every year, and that has not happened, and we cannot see it anywhere in the budget. And today, in real terms, the growth is only 5% GDP. And at this rate, how are you going to be able to achieve what you're exposing to us? And the GST has been hailed as a great key reform since independence. But sadly, the model and implementation has been flawed since the very beginning. Many of us supported it, hoping that it will bring ease of business. But it hasn't brought ease of business. It's actually closed on many industries, and the entire industry, and especially small traders, are in distress. And the system is... got several glitches, and it is evident when the finance minister summoned the Infosys for explanations. The finance minister in the budget said our government is committed to the goal of doubling farmers' incomes by 2020. The agriculture sector has just grown by 2% in the first quarter of this year as compared to 5.1% growth in the previous quarter in the last year. And the RBI annual report shows that the contribution of agriculture in the last 5 years has halved. At this, and the Niti Aayog report says that you need a 14% growth to double the farmers' income. At this pace, how can we double the farmers' income? And the National Crime Records Bureau report in 2018 says that 10,349 people working in the farm sector have ended their lives. I'd like to say that it is not because nature has been brutal to them. The insurance scheme, crop insurance scheme, which had to protect them and protect their crops and their livelihoods, did not. It failed to do so. It's a shame that many farmers in Tamil Nadu received as little as 4 rupees, 5 rupees, and even 10 rupees as crop insurance. And this was highlighted by our party leader, M.K. Stalin, in the Tamil Nadu Assembly, that farmers got as little as 5 rupees as crop insurance. The farmers have been paying around 610 rupees per acre premium for insurance and spending more than 30,000 rupees per acre for cultivation. And the insurance amount sanctioned to them is highly insulting. 3 years and 7 crop seasons after it was rolled out, the center's flagship farm insurance scheme remains behind its own target, and its outreach is as low as 26%. The least the government could have done is to provide immediate relief for the farmers by waiving off the farmers' loans, which has been their demand for a very long time, and we saw the farmers protesting in Delhi also.
Were totally ignored.
The UPA government in 2008 waived off more than 72,000 crores of farm loans, which provided the much needed relief to the farmers as well as the rural economy. And our friend Mr. Sinha here, he's talking about old age pensions reaching the old people all over the country. If he comes with me to my constituency, I can show him that every day hundreds of old men and women come with petitions, and they're waiting, and they've been waiting for years to get their old age pensions, and I really don't know where this amazing blissful place is he's talking about. You come with me. And one of the biggest schemes that have the capacity to actually put money in the hands of the people is the MNREGA. And it was mentioned here by the Congress speaker from the Congress, that Manish Tiwari ji, that there's been a steep fall in the money allocated for the MNREGA. And in MNREGA's financial statement as of January 26, 2020 has shown that more than 96% of the allocated money has already been spent or is needed to pay pending dues. Less than 2,500 crore is left to sustain the scheme, and nearly 15 states are already in the red. A minimum of 96,000 crores is needed to implement the MNREGA in the coming year. And the national average wage of MNREGA worker is around 178 per day, less than half of the 375 per day minimum wage recommended by the Labour Ministry panel. I request the government to increase the wages at least to 350 rupees. The 15th Finance Commission. DMK has always been at the forefront of the struggle for federalism and decentralization. It is entirely with this objective that I wish to highlight the unfair ways in which the 15th Finance Commission tills the fiscal scale in the center's favor. The 14th Finance Commission had promised that there will be incentives for the states that undertook measures to control population explosion. But the 15th Finance Commission is using demography as the sole benchmark. The 15th Finance Commission has the 2011 census as the sole criteria for the population, but has reduced the weightage of the population to 15% from the earlier 27.5%. It is extremely unjust to punish states like Tamil Nadu and the southern states that have achieved a neutral net reproductive rate targets. The 15th Finance Commission has granted 4,025 crores to Tamil Nadu for post-devolution grant, but this is only a temporary relief. We need a permanent justice to be done to the southern states, which are highly affected by this. And in July 2019, the terms of reference of the Finance Commission were amended to include allocation of resources towards defense and internal security imperatives. Experts have noted that this is an unprecedented move to raise funds for the country's defense security from the states. This is erroneous and unfair, as defense comes under the union government. Why should the states pay for something which comes entirely under the center's purview unless you intend to move defense to the concurrent list? We have gone from times when the union government would finance states and incentivize good schemes. Now, the programs run by the center and state, the center has been consistently reducing its contribution, and this is very unfair. And in your budget, you had said, you always say, make in India and it will create jobs. Now you're saying study in India through the INSAT. But what are we actually making? Are we making sure that people will come to India and study here? Are we making the university safe for people to even come here? Recently, we sent back a German student who was studying in the IIT Madras because he participated in the anti-CA protests. So, and our university campuses like JNU and Jamia, the way the students were attacked, how can we convince the world community that our universities and colleges are a safe place for students to study? And I like to quote John F. Kennedy, who says, "Those who make peaceful resistance impossible will make violent revolution inevitable." Disinvestment. Listing of companies on stock exchange is discipline a company and provides access to financial markets. This is what the finance minister said in her budget. I'd like to say that actually the LIC was nationalized only because they were unfair trade practices. And that is why it became a government sector. And in 1990, the insurance sector was open to private sector, and the LIC has been doing remarkably well among the other insurance companies. There's no reason to disinvest the LIC other than the government's desperate attempt to raise money through disinvestment, as they are failing in realizing tax revenue targets. And I'd like to borrow the words of Adada, who keeps saying, don't sell the family silver. That is exactly what we are doing, and these are very desperate times. And I'd like to say that these private companies do not have any commitment, or they're not legally bound to give reservation in their companies or industries. And the more you disinvest and the more you give away the public sector investments and companies to private, the amount of jobs given to people to rectify injustice which has been done to people for centuries, that is reservation. That has been cut drastically. And this is just not a wrong economic move to disinvest, but also it is against social justice, and it's taking away, I think you're hacking at the roots of social justice in this country by disinvesting. We were talking about unemployment, and I think it's often been quoted that it's at a 45-year high. But it is very alarming to see that nearly our urban youth are unemployed. 22.5% of the urban youth are unemployed, and it's worse in the rural sector. I'd like to bring to your notice what happened in Salem recently in Tamil Nadu. A woman who lost her husband could not find employment, and she sold her hair for 150 rupees to feed her three children. And then she said, I don't have anything more to sell to support my family. This is the state this country is, and we are talking about $10 trillion economies. The budget allocation to welfare schemes is a key measure of our commitment to development goals. Under the National Program for Midday Meal Schools, in the budget estimates for 2019-20 was 11,000 crores, but the revised estimates is 9,912 crores. In September 2019, a journalist was booked for conspiracy after he reported that only rotis and salt are being served in a midday meal in the government school in Uttar Pradesh. In this situation, how can the government justify the 1,088 crore lesser funds for this project? And for the umbrella ICDS scheme, the BE 2019-20 was 27,584 crores, but the RE 2019-20 was 24,995. There is a decrease of 2,589 crores. This lowering of spending for the ICDs is not justified when India has the highest number of under five deaths, according to the UNICEF report of 2018. And I'd like to talk about the MSMEs. With the introduction of the GST and demonetization, the twin attack on the Indian economy, the MSME sectors were challenged. And according to the government policy note of Tamil Nadu, the AIADMK government, which is your ally, that more than 50,000 MSMEs have been closed and 5 lakh jobs have been lost. The MSMEs are reeling under the credit crunch created by demonetization. Banks are lending loans to MSMEs at a rate of 11%, and since the repayment has been computerized, even if there's a small error in repaying returns, the MSMEs are declared NPAs, and they have to clear all the dues to be declared as non-NPA. And their non-banking financial corporations are apprehensive to lend money to the MSMEs and charging a interest rate of 15 to 17%, which is too high. And the debt service coverage ratio parameters, which is used to assess the ability to repay the loans by the firm, is the same for the MSMEs and the corporates. This should be rationalized according to the needs of the MSMEs. The matchbox industry, which is particularly prominent in my constituency, Thoothukudi, they've been demanding that the GST for matches to be reduced from 18% to 5% because they're partly handmade. I myself have written to the finance minister, and they've also come and met you and requested you to give them a reduction in the GST. I request the finance minister to kindly consider this, because the entire sector is in distress and they are closing down.
Last page.
In 2019, over 4,000 hours of internet shutdown has cost India over 9,300 crores. While the government continues to deny that there's no negative impact on tourism, there has been an 18% fall in tourists in December 2019 alone, resulting in heavy losses for both hospitality and tourism sectors. Several world leaders have expressed their displeasure over the CAA and the Kashmir shutdown, and they've cancelled their visits to India. Recently, several investment firms are reducing their Indian government bond holdings on concerns over the CAA and also diverting funds to other countries. Certainly, the combination of the abrogation of Article 370 and the CAA implementation is forcing the world to take a step back from India. Is this the India we aspire and strive to be?
No.
Iyatralum, Iyatralum, the Tirukural, which I think everybody is fond of quoting here.
Yes, Kanimaraji.
Iyatralum, Iyatralum, Kaathalum, Kaathavagutalum, Valladaras. Generating revenue justly, increasing its earnings to the exchequer, protecting the same and distributing it fairly are the attributes of a good government. But unfortunately, I cannot say these things about this government. Thank you.
Thank you.